Ja, parkiral sem, zato nisem mogel, ker sem jih parkiral tam. Ja. Aha.
Morning all.
Dej, poklič potem, čau.
Čau,
Raz. Hello.
Okay, let's just start with our usual weekly research seminar. So today, Nastja Cepak is with us. So she will be lecturing about post-quantum cryptography. And this is the first lecture in a series of seminars that will be prepared by members of our Center of Cryptography. I think, Nastja, there will be five of.
Yes, hopefully five, yes.
Ah. So
four most definitely, and the fifth one is in preparation stages.
Okay, okay. So Nastja, you have the honor to be the first one of this series. So let's just start.
Thank you very much, Stefko. So hello to everyone from my side as well. As Stefko already said, this will be the first in a series of cryptographic talks. Now, to ease us into it nicely, today I will be basically talking about post-quantum cryptography, not that much from the strictly mathematical point of view, but I'm going more for an overview of what is going on right now with the post-quantum cryptography, why is this important, and to maybe give you a quick motivation as to why the research that we do, or at least one aspect of the research areas that we do uncover, are very interesting, both from the mathematical point of view and from the real world applications. So just a few brief words also for the general public before we start. All of us that will be having these talks, cryptographic talks, are from the Center of Cryptography, which is a relatively new center. It was started in 2018 with the leader as our professor, Enes Pasalic. So this is a picture of all our members together with the newest member, Amar. Here we see our leader, Enes Pasalic. He was also awarded the Joyce Award just last year. So in total, we are one full professor, one docent, one assistant with PhD, and three PhD students. To not drag this on for too long, if the Slovene-speaking audience would also like to hear something more about the center and about the cryptography in general, I added a quick link here to the YouTube page where there's an interview with the center, and you can get a few more details there. A quick overview of what we do research-wise. So you could say that our main area of research are Boolean functions with specific properties, in our case, with high non-linearity. So we research band functions, APN functions, AB functions, their properties, how they behave, how we can classify them, construct them in similar. All of this research is ultimately linked to block ciphers and S-boxes. And we are, in fact, researching how to improve them, optimize them, and so on. We do also some cryptanalysis, among it, Samir, one of our members, in the past year, 2 years, has focused more on quantum cryptanalysis. We research also permutations over finite fields, again, their properties, classifications, how can they be used in constructions and similar. Ultimately, our research is, we cooperate with researchers from many different countries. Among them, I would point out just France, Germany, Denmark, China, and a few others, but these are our most important collaborations. So for the next talks, my colleagues will basically present to you various topics from these research topics. So what we do mathematically, they will go into more in-depth mathematics. But today, from my side, I would basically like to focus on why we do this mathematics. So on one side, we have this beautiful, elegant mathematical insights that lead us to these cryptographic constructs. On the other side, also, we get motivation from the applicational point of view. So in the outside world, when we are talking about cryptography, about computer security, about cybersecurity, where does our cryptography in fact fit into it? So since we will be talking about post-quantum cryptography today, which is just one of the aspects where cryptography is, let's say, used in the outside world, first, I would like to focus on just a few main differences between the classical computers as we understand them, use them today, and the quantum computers. I will correct this on the slides later on. Just so that we are on the same page, so and we understand why they behave in so vastly different ways. Maybe the easiest aspect of it is classical computers, well, they use classical bits. We know how these bits behave. They can take either the value of zero or one. And so if we are talking about a two-bit state, well, how many values can we actually encode into it? Well, four of them, 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 0, 1, 1. And that's pretty straightforward. Now, the quantum computers, on the other hand, do not behave in this same instinctive way that we understand. So they use qubits. Now, one qubit, it can take the value 0 or 1, but it can also take infinitely many superpositions in between. So when we're talking about two qubits, these two can encode any superposition of the four states that we mentioned before. So already here we can see that there are vastly different ways in how the bits versus qubits behave. One of the consequences of this is how the computation ends, right? So with the classical computers, we expect the computation to end with a single bit state. So we expect a series of zeros and ones to be produced at the end. Now with the quantum computers, the computation actually ends when we decide to stop the computation and measure the results. When we say measure the results, that means that at that point, the superpositions collapse back into the zeros and ones that we can actually read. But what is the difference there is that with the classical computers, the result is always deterministic. But with the quantum computers, it's probabilistic. So if you run the same computation 10 times, you don't really have the guarantee that all 10 results will be the same. Because when we're talking about superpositions, that basically kind of measures what possibility do you have for the superposition to collapse into a one and what probability you have for the superposition to collapse into a zero. So this is why this computational part with the measuring results is very important, and also why quantum computers behave in such a vastly different way than what we are used to with the classical computers because of this probability in the background. Because of this, there are, in general, many also misunderstandings of how the quantum computers actually behave. So there are a lot of kind of myths and wonderings surrounding them. And I've gathered a few of them here, just so that we can briefly get our ideas straight, what we are actually talking about when we say a quantum computer, right? So one of the most popular questions will come, quantum computers one day completely replace the classical computers. Well, we have seen that they behave in vastly different ways. And when we are talking about complete replacement, the answer would be no, I really don't think that will ever happen because you still need your mobile phone to work in certain ways. You still need your computer to work in certain ways that are definitely not probabilistic, right? So classical and quantum computers will at some point probably coexist side by side, but they will be definitely dedicated to different use cases. The next one that is also quite popular, did we already achieve the quantum supremacy? About a year ago, you probably remember Google published their article claiming to have achieved quantum supremacy. Then IBM tried to refute that and so on. A good question at this point would also be what quantum supremacy would actually mean for us, that quantum computers are able to break some real life cryptographic algorithms, that they are able to execute some other specific operation in real time, which normal computers would take millions of years for, or something similar. So in general, I would say, I don't think that quantum supremacy as such has already been achieved, but a lot of progress is being done in this area. IBM itself has also released a white paper saying that they fully expect to be able to construct a quantum computer with 1,000 qubits by the end of, I think it was 2024. So if we are talking about the number of qubits and how powerful that quantum computer would be, we can say that this is an incredibly short amount of time. So we are not quite there yet, but the great progress is being made. Also, are quantum computers already commercially available? As such, can you actually go and buy a quantum computer? Not as such, not yet. What is available though is it is possible to buy computers relying on certain quantum mechanics in the background, such as D-Wave. You can also access quantum simulators, and in certain cases, you can even kind of buy some time on actual physical qubits, so you can basically run some of your very basic programs in cloud. So again, we are moving in that direction. But the topic that I would actually like to present today is, of course, linked to cryptography and subsequently to our digital security. So what would an arrival of a fully functioning quantum computer mean for our digital security? So this is something that I would like to cover today. Now, quantum computer will affect different types of our cryptographic algorithms in different ways. This is why I would first like to just briefly say that we recognize two most important and biggest families of cryptographic algorithms, and these are symmetric cryptography and asymmetric cryptography. Briefly, what is the difference between them? With symmetric cryptography, we have just one encryption key and we use it to both encrypt our plain text and decrypt it, okay? So encryption, decryption, and we have the same cryptographic key. Maybe if you already have heard of these algorithms that your computers use and so on, symmetric cryptography would include algorithms like DES, 3DES, IS. Now, DES is a very old algorithm. Hopefully you will never encounter it in practice. 3DES is really old as well, but it's still being used in the banking sector, weirdly enough. While the IS is the current cryptographic standard that we have and is already widely implemented, and I hope that it will substitute 3DES as soon as possible. Then the other big family of algorithms that we know is the asymmetric cryptography and asymmetric algorithms. Now, as the name already tells you, this time we are not dealing with just one encryption key, okay? This time we are dealing with a pair of encryption keys that are of course mathematically linked. So we have the public key and the private key. What you encrypt with the public key can be decrypted with your private key, and the other way around. What is encrypted with the private key can be decrypted with the public key. There are two main groups of algorithms that we built on this asymmetric principle, and those are the RSA algorithm and the elliptic curves. Now, I think that most of the audience has at least briefly heard about RSA before, and how it uses the prime numbers and so on. RSA basically relies on the fact that factorizing integers back into their prime factors is a very difficult problem that we are not capable of solving, let's say, in any kind of real time. On the other hand, we also have the elliptic curves. Now, in general, I think that elliptic curves are not as well known as RSA, so I have prepared one slide just to briefly give you some basic background on how the elliptic curves actually work. Again, very simple and straightforward. So you have your elliptic curve, and you have two points on this curve, right? So the elliptic curves rely on adding these points together, right? So how the addition works. So you have two points, and how do you add them up? Well, you connect them with a line, and this line will intersect the elliptic curve in exactly one point, right? And then the agreement is that you take this point and find the mirror image. So you kind of put it above the line, right, the x-axis, and you get the point R. And it was decided that this is the way we add points. So P plus Q equals R. This is the addition of points on elliptic curves. Now, every asymmetric algorithm is based on one operation being very simple and fast to execute, and the reverse of that operation being very difficult to execute. Okay? So what is the simple computation in this point? Well, it would be adding two points together. That is very simple and straightforward operation. The hard one would be, though, suppose that you are given some kind of point P and some kind of point Q, which is just P plus P plus P plus P plus P. Now, given P and Q, you have to find the integer n. So how many times did you have to add P to itself to get Q? Now, this reverse operation is very difficult to execute. It's basically the discrete logarithm problem, and we do not know how to solve it efficiently. With the elliptic curves, we have some additional things with kind of curve we can choose, but maybe we leave this part for now. So why did I in fact introduce you to this symmetric and asymmetric cryptography? Well, I did it because the quantum algorithms impact them in vastly different ways. Here we see a table. First off, we can look at the asymmetric cryptography, right? So we have the algorithms listed. We see the bits of security that a classical computer can provide to us with respect to a certain algorithm, and then the bits of security that remain to us after a quantum computer exists. So after we are able to attack these algorithms with quantum algorithms and quantum attacks. So asymmetric cryptography, the most widely used algorithms, RSA 2K, 4K and up, and elliptic curves. We see that the bits of security we get is between 112 and 256. And that's really nice because for brute force attacks with the classical computer, the minimum number of bits of security we demand is at least 110, 112, okay? Anything below that is already considered insecure because already with the computing power we have today, we have now, we could be able to crack this with a simple brute force search. Now, the worrying thing is the red zero over here, right? The bottom line is once we are able to use the quantum algorithms, specifically in our case, Shor's algorithm, we can reduce all of these bits of security in case of asymmetric cryptography to zero. Basically, what Shor's algorithm can do, among other things, is it can factorize the integers very quickly back into their prefactors, which in fact breaks the RSA. And it can also solve discrete logarithm problem effectively, which breaks the elliptic curves problem. So you see that it breaks the underlying mathematical problem which our algorithms rely on. In practice, this means that at some point we will lose the asymmetric cryptography as we know it today. Now, the symmetric cryptography, on the other hand, you have probably already seen it from the table, it fares better than the asymmetric ones. What happens is, using Grover's algorithm this time, the number of bits of security that an algorithm can provide to us is reduced by half. So what does Grover's algorithm in fact do? It speeds up our search algorithms by a square factor. In practice, this means that it halves the number of bits of security for both symmetric cryptography and also the hash functions. I wasn't mentioning the hash functions by themselves, but that's a good note to have. So again, what does that mean for the algorithms that we're using today? I won't even be mentioning the SN3 DES. We can already think of them as kind of old and redundant. But for IS, now IS is a very good algorithm, widely used and so on. So IS-128, it gets its number of bits of security reduced by half, and we end up with 56 bits of security. Now, that is simply not enough, because we said before that we demand at least 110, 112 bits of security. So after applying the quantum attack using Grover's algorithm, we are reduced the number of bits of security that we can then crack using the classical computer with a brute force attack. Now, IS-256, on the other hand, is reduced to 128 bits of security, and it is still safe. So out of the algorithms listed here, only IS-256 will survive an attack with a quantum computer. This is the reason why this IS-256 is in fact the only and also the first algorithm that NSA publicly endorsed for being used in encrypting top secret documents, which is an interesting bit of information. So this was quite, let's say, theoretical. What I would like to also show you or briefly comment is, okay, where is asymmetric cryptography in fact being used? So which aspects of our lives would it actually impact? Did you maybe already use at some point any digital certificates? Maybe to sign in into your online banks, to sign some other documents and similar. Digital certificates rely on other RSA or elliptic curves. Did you ever use electronic signatures? Did you sign your mail? Did you have to, let's say, prove your identity in some kind of online environment? Usually, certificates and asymmetric cryptography is being used in the background. Did you ever access a web page and it told you, oh, the digital certificate here expired, maybe this web page is not safe? Again, RSA usually. For example, in this call right now, in the back, TLS is being run. Now, TLS itself does encryption with symmetric cryptography, but to exchange the symmetric keys, which you remember, both sides need to have the same key in order for symmetric crypto to work. Now, in order to exchange this key, asymmetric cryptography is used. So basically, maybe for those who know this internet protocols a bit more, we lose TLS, IPsec, SSH, because the key exchange is not safe anymore. Usually here we use the Diffie-Hellman key exchange. So any authentication of processes, servers, and similar, basically any scenario when you have either a physical person, a server, a process that needs to prove their identity online, we lose all of that. We use traditional blockchain authentication, which relies on elliptic curves. Then of course, it depends on how exactly your keys are derived, but some of them can be cracked as well. Internet of Things usually has some kind of PKI infrastructure implemented. Again, we lose that security. Now, in which areas do we in fact use this technology? Well, almost in any kind of area you think of. You have them, some of them just listed here on the slide. So IKT, obviously, finance, health, traffic, public or under government, you name it, basically, it is used in almost all of these levels. But the next question, of course, quantum computer, we don't have a quantum computer yet that would be able, maybe to not confuse with this slide for now, that would be able to crack, let's say, an RSA-2K. We do not have it yet. Of course, the question then is, how soon will we have it? Now, we don't have that answer just yet. It depends on which, let's say, leading scientist you ask. The answer could be anything between 10 and 50 years. So we still have some time. But the question then would be, if we still have that much time, why would we plan for it now? And I have a few reasons or questions for that gathered here today, for just a bit of a motivation why thinking about post-quantum cryptography is really relevant. Well, one part would be, once the cryptography is broken, we already need new cryptography, already prepared, tested, and so on, and basically ready to go, so that we are not caught, let's say, in a world where we lose all digital security. So this is the part that, let's say, we as mathematicians and cryptographers are doing. Next thing is, once all these standards are ready, and we will talk about standards in a moment, well, the outside world, right? The industry and all of these, well, implementations, they still need to migrate from the old algorithms to new ones. And this, again, takes a lot of time. Historically speaking, right? How did we do with these migrations in the past? Some of the main migrations that we have already encountered in the past are migration from DES to 3DES and now to IS. And I must say that we're doing quite badly there, especially because most of the banking sector and basically the finances in the background are still relying on the 3DES algorithm. Basically, when you go and pay anything with your card, for your payment to be verified, a number of encryptions and decryptions happen in the background on various parts of the globe. And let's say that at least half of them still use 3DES, which is, by today's computational standards, not really all that safe anymore. And it's supposed to be completely replaced by IS in at least the next 3 or maximum 4 years. Those are the current NIST guidelines. We have also encountered migrations from hash algorithms that were broken, such as MD5 and SHA-1. Again, we needed a lot of time for that migration, and you can still encounter certificates being used that use MD5 or SHA-1 for their signature schemes. So to be honest, we're not doing all that good with these migration processes. They are basically taking more than 10 years to execute. So our record here is quite bad, I must say. An additional motivation, or maybe a question or so for you to think a bit about. So what happens if somebody today intercepts some data that you are sending? Internet traffic, banking information. Maybe we're talking even about some top secret documents that are not encrypted with IS-256. So what happens, you know? This person, this organization, can go and store this data. I mean, storing data is not that, doesn't cost that much. If you are thinking in terms of some global organization or global company or a government, intercepting incredible amounts of data and storing them is not that much of a problem. Now, among the data is definitely some that will be still relevant and really important, let's say 50 years from now, or maybe just 30 years from now, right? So in theory, they can intercept everything, store it, so they're intercepting encrypted data right now, right? And they cannot break it yet. But they store it, and 30, maybe 50 years from now, they use a quantum computer and break the encryption and gain the data. Most of it will be completely useless by then, but some of it won't. So these are the interesting things that we're encountering. Additionally, if you consider the cryptographic scene, right? Let's say from the Second World War onwards, a trend that we have often encountered is that when some new either theoretical or mechanical breakthrough is made, it is not immediately made public. For example, differential cryptanalysis was known by NSA 20 years before it became publicly known. Now, right now, we have no guarantee that we will know when a first quantum computer that is able to break our current cryptography will be made functional. The probability that it will be done by some government or some army is, statistically speaking, quite high. So when we do get the public, let's say, confirmation that there actually exists a fully functioning quantum computer that is able to break our encryption, it is probably quite probable that this will be, in a sense, old news by then. So we have all of these things going on, which kind of motivate us to think about post-quantum algorithms and similar already now and today. Because of this, NIST has already, in 2016, started the standardization process for PQC algorithms, so post-quantum cryptography algorithms. So right now, just a brief comment, maybe. You see at the end of 2016, the first general register notice was put out calling for PQC submissions. 82 were received out of those. Some were very quickly cracked, or some serious vulnerabilities were found in them. So 69 were accepted for the first round. End of January 2019, first round ended, and we got the candidates for the second round. You see also during that time, standardization conferences were held where mathematicians, cryptographers, software implementers, various representations of companies, NIST representators, and so on gathered and discussed these algorithms. And constantly cryptographic work was being done, trying to, on one hand, crack these candidates, so to find vulnerabilities. This is what the cryptanalysis do. And then on the other hand, you had teams trying to correct these vulnerabilities, make the algorithms even faster, more optimal, to enhance their behavior and so on. This is the cryptographic side. Just a few months ago, July of this year, we actually got the finalists, so the winners of the second round. At the same time, the third round started. The third round is expected to be the final round of this standardization process, and we are hoping to already have the first post-quantum cryptography standardization drafts by next year, 2 years at the most. The COVID process impacted this process as well, but we really are hoping that in a year, year and a half, we'll actually be able to talk about the first post-quantum cryptography standards being accepted. So this is a great and very also exciting time to be in this quantum cryptography and to see how things are developing, progressing, which candidates are being chosen and so on. This is also why I would like to comment just a bit on these chosen candidates that actually made it to the third round. A brief comment so that we understand why we have this division between candidates where algorithms will be used for public key encryption and separately algorithms that will be used for digital signatures, right? here we encounter another big change that will happen in the cryptographic, let's say, ecosystem with the coming of the post-quantum cryptography. Up to now, we have been used to using RSA or elliptic curves for both of these use cases, okay? So you could use RSA for both public key encryption and digital signature compared to PQC algorithms. RSA and elliptic curves were very nice, very optimal algorithms. We have not yet managed to find a PQC algorithm that would be so nicely optimized as these two that we are used to for now. So if I comment briefly on the finalists, next to the algorithms, I wrote also which underlying problem the algorithms are relying on. So if RSA relied on factorizing big numbers, if elliptic curves relied on the discrete logarithm problem, you see that most of the finalists here are relying on lattice-based problems. Just classic McAllis and the rainbow algorithms are relying on something else. Classic McAllis is in fact a really old algorithm. It was already defined in the 70s, I think, and it relies on a purely coding problem. It wasn't widely used and implemented because its performance is far worse than that of RSA or elliptic curves. But it is it survives a quantum attack. So now it is one of the prime candidates, also because it has already been, it's an old algorithm. It has already been widely studied. Its properties are very, very well known and so on. The rest of these algorithms are far newer ones. And one of the wishes that NIST has is that you see that most of them, again, rely on these lattice problems. NIST would like to have some, to not have all of its standards rely on just one algorithm. We don't know really what the future brings, what new algorithms, either on quantum or on classical attacks, will discover. So we will have more than just one PQC standard per use case. So it is a very high probability that classic McAllis will be one of the standardized algorithms together with at least one of the lattice candidates. Similar is true for digital signatures. It is quite probable that rainbow will be standardized as the one relying on some multivariable problem together with either Crystal's Dilithium or Falcon. You see also here that Crystal's Dilithium and Crystal's Kyber are both related, but they are just related. They are not the same algorithm, okay? A similar team of cryptographers and developers is also working on them, but again, they are not the same algorithm. So we didn't yet manage to get one algorithm to cover both public encryption and digital signatures. Additionally, we also have some reserve candidates that are also going into the third round, but they are not yet prime candidates for standardization. Now, NIST expects these algorithms to still be improved and worked on. And maybe after the first standardization drafts are made, maybe after that, some of these alternative candidates can be in the later years additionally added to the standard. You see that here we have a bit more diversity in the problems that the algorithms rely on. We encounter algorithms relying on hash functions, which if you think about it, kind of makes sense. We did say that Grover's algorithm does not completely break hash functions, right? It just reduces the bits of security. So hash functions can be some of the components that we will probably encounter in our next generation algorithms. Additionally, Psyche is one of the, let's say, alternative candidates most likely to be standardized at some point, simply because it relies on elliptic curve isogenies, which none of the other candidates. To also demonstrate maybe a bit better how different the performances are of these algorithms versus the algorithms that we already know today. Here is one table. On one side, you have the size of signatures, right? This is your y-axis and it's in bytes. On your x-axis, size of the public key, right? Please note that the rule here is exponential, right? 10, 100, 1000, so on. So in one corner, we see elliptic curves and RSA. So these are the algorithms that are actually implemented in our systems today, and we know their behavior, right? Now, if you look at the rest of the table, you see that the rest of these new PQC algorithms perform in vastly different ways. Either they have an expected size of the public key, but then their signature size is enormous. And there would have to be big modifications done in our systems to accommodate the size of signature. These are mostly algorithms that are based on either hash functions or on symmetric functions. Then you have multivariate algorithms that kind of go all over the place, but are basically located here. So with size of a signature that we kind of know, expect and know how to handle, but again, on the other hand, very, very big public key that we don't really know, again, how to accommodate. Then you have the lattice problems, and maybe it also makes sense why they are among the most popular solutions, because they kind of keep this ratio between the size of the public key and size of the signature, mostly. But the underlying fact is still that this adoption to the PQC algorithms will probably be a quite interesting one. And you know, I think that for the entire cryptographic community, this will be a very interesting time that is coming. So just one note, keep in mind that when these new PQC algorithms are being developed, you need teams with mathematicians. And this is basically what we do on Fundit, right? We are dealing with these basic mathematical concepts and so on. You need people then that are able to optimize this with respect to software, with respect to hardware, the implementations. You need people to attempt to attack these ciphers with cryptanalysis and so on. And so much work is going into developing these PQC algorithms. And basically, I think it will be a very interesting to see how everything will develop in the following years. So this was basically the main things that I wanted to present to you today. So if you have any questions, either related to what we do or to PQC or how these algorithms will be used, I think that this is a great time.
Okay, Nastja, thank you first for your very nice talk. And so now it's time for questions. So please.
Can I ask a question?
Okay.
Can you maybe explain what a lattice problem is like in basics? Because this is not the posit lattice we are used to know, or at least
time. Yeah, it's not. Okay, at this point, I must say that I didn't yet delve that deeply into it. So right now, maybe I would not be the best person to really present this. But one of our colleagues, Samir, is actually working on this quantum cryptanalysis. And in that case, I would maybe suggest that the last talk will probably be his. And I would maybe rather suggest that he at least briefly explains and covers this explanation of the lattice problem in his talk, maybe in the beginning or something like that. Would that be fine?
Yes, thank you. Great.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. Further questions? Okay, if not, let's thank to Nastja once again, and I'm sure that there will be many other opportunities for questions about cryptography. As we said, there will be 4 talks from now on in a row about cryptography given by the members of our Center for Cryptography. So Nastja, thank you again, and see you, see all of you next Monday.
Yeah, thank you very much, and we'll be seeing everyone. Also, as I said, the next talks will be more mathematical, and we'll go more into the mathematical depths of everything.
Okay, thank you, and
thank you.
Bye.
Bye.